Hello, community. Today, we talk about parameter-efficient fine-tuning. And one method in parameter-efficient fine-tuning is LoRA. Let's focus on this today. And the main idea behind this, we have huge models where we have a lot of VRAM. How can we reduce here our model that even with a less powerful GPU, we can do the calculation, for example, fine-tuning an LLM, or do a stable diffusion job. So here we go. PEFT LoRA, when we look at the use cases, we can tune different transformer models. For example, if you say from Big Science, the company that used Bloom, you have here the T0 model. This is the T5 XL model for zero-shot optimization. And you want to integrate this with HuggingFace Accelerate and with Deep Speed with a 0.3 offloading. And if you look at this file, and I will show you the code in one of the next videos, you have some zero optimization that offloads the optimizer memory and the computation from the GPU to a CPU. Why? Because Deep Speed has a specific Atom optimizer for CPU that is really fast. So we can do quite a lot of things here to reduce our memory footprint. Or if you go for integer 8 tuning here of some models, and we want to do it in a free Google Colab notebook, we can use here HuggingFace PEFT plus LoRA plus Bits and Bytes. Bits and Bytes is a lightweight wrapper. I wrote some CUDA custom function on your graphic card, on the CUDA course, the tensor course. In particular, it is an 8-bit optimizer. We are talking about matrix multiplication and quantification functions. So, and if you look in those programs, the first line you will encounter is from PEFT import LoRA configuration and get your PEFT model. And you might ask, hey, so what is my optimal LoRA configuration for my model and what the hell is a PEFT model? So here we go. Let's understand it. 3 points. At first, we're going to talk about adapter transformers. This is an extension of Hugging Face transformers that will give us a very beautiful explanation of what is LoRA. And you will see that LoRA is integrated in a new library by Hugging Face. And this library is called PEFT, Parameter Efficient Fine Tuning, where the Hugging Face library takes here a pre-trained LLM and freezes most of the parameters. Now, LoRA does now a particular job that it takes those frozen pre-trained model weights and injects trainable matrices into each layer of the transformer. So we modify the architecture of our transformer. And since we have transformer in LLM, in vision, in stable diffusion, in whisper, in vision transformers, you see this method here has a wide array of application. So let's start at the beginning in June 2019. Holsby published here parameter efficient transfer learning for NLP. And he more or less said, fine tuning involves copying the weights from a pre-trained network or a transformer network and tuning them on a downstream task, which produces a new set of weight for each task. So multitask learning requires simultaneous access to a lot of tasks, and therefore we need a lot of memory. It is a very memory-intensive fine-tuning. He came up with, the authors came up with the idea of adapters. An adapter, they discover, yields some parameter-efficient tuning for NLP. In particular, it has a very nice feature. It permits training, fine-tuning on tasks sequentially. So what are those adapters? It involves here adding a small number of new parameters to a model, which are then trained on the downstream task. So in adapter tuning, so remember, we have fine-tuning and we go now here for adapter tuning because the difference is all the parameters of the original pre-trained network or transformer or LLM or vision transformer are frozen. They are kept identical and therefore can be shared by many tasks. And we have only here our adapters that we are gonna adapter tune now to our downstream task. You might say, okay, can you show me a visualization? Here we are. So adapter tuning involves for the task of fine-tuning, injection of new architectural layers into our transformer architecture. And you say, hey, finally, transform, it was so easy, it was so trivial, so simple. Finally, we have here a little bit more that we want to understand. So here we go. So for example, here on the decoder, you have your multi-headed attention, you have your feed-forward layer, and then you see here a new layer, what's called an adapter. Or you have here now in this structure here, feed-forward layers, and then also an adapter. So what the adapter do is more or less project here the maps, the feature size back to the size of the layer input. Let's have a look at this maybe in a little bit more detail. There are now for each task, you have now, you can train now a specific adapter. And if you have, I don't know, 100 tasks, you will get 100 adapters. So the idea was here by Pfeiffer to establish a hub where all the adapters from all the models that were adapter tuned can be accumulated and are available for everybody else. So this was the idea of Adapter Hub, a framework for adapting transformers. Yes, 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 if you want, you read the literature, but it was very easy to implement. So from the transformer, you choose your model and your adapter type. Then you had your classification from a pre-trained here, for example, a Roberta-based model. And then you just said model.addAdapter. You had here your specific training data set. You had to choose an adapter type. I'll show you in a second what I mean. And a specific configuration. I'll also show you in a second. And then you just said model.trainAdapter on my specific data set for this adapter tuning of the LLM of the transformer architecture. And then the beautiful thing was, since everything else was frozen, only the adapter parameters were trained, you could then extract the adapter weight values out of the transformer architecture and said, save only the adapter weights, only the trained weights of this model, and then you could upload it here, for example, to the adapter hub. And you say for a particular model, Roberta base, with a specific data set, SSD2, with a specific configuration of my adapter, then this is the adapter for a text task, SSD2, and everybody could use this adapter. So this was the adapter hub. Yes, 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 trained, you know everything, you can read it in detail. Now, there are two famous architecture, very simple. We have the original Holsby architecture with two adapter in our layer, and then we have the Pfeiffer architecture with just one adapter. Find out, yeah, although it's possible you don't need two, just one here is sufficient for the performance. If you want to have here a look at the detail, you find this here on the left side. But let me show you the training process, the benefit it provided. So you had a model and you want now to have here an adapter tuning of this particular model. So you choose your adapter and you run here this adapter tuning with a particular data set on your machine. And after the adapter tuning is done, you can extract here the adapter weights, the training adapter, let's call it this, and feed this, I don't know, 1 megabyte size data set back here into our hub. And then another person says, yes, I load now the same model, and now I can also download the pre-trained adapter weights here. So my inference task is now optimized for the downstream task that this adapter was trained here by this person. So on this hub here, a lot of adapter for a lot of different data set for a lot of different tasks accumulated. Beautiful. And you might say, is this now PEFT? No. This is here adapter hub, but it is very close. It is very similar. Let me show you. So what we had is now we could have this stitching in task specific tuned adapter into our transformer models. So we injected here our adapter, our little additional layers here in our transformer network. And as I showed you, it was done simple model. If you had a adapter trained adapter, you just said model load this adapter with the data set, with the configuration, and you could use it. Beautiful. So now this adapter had a very particular beneficial function. Now, if we use fine-tuning, the classical fine-tuning, and we fine-tune on one task and two tasks and 100 tasks and 300 tasks, this sequential fine-tuning and multitask learnings are methods aiming to incorporate more and more knowledge from multiple tasks in your model. However, they suffer here from something that's called catastrophic forgetting. If you have 100 data sets and you have 100 different tasks and you go sequential fine-tuning, sequential fine-tuning, sequential fine-tuning, sometimes the model overrides and starts to forget what it learned 100 tasks before. So to address this shortcoming, adapter were a perfect solution. And here, Pfeiffer, again, proposed here Adapter Fusion. This is now a new two-stage learning algorithm that leverages knowledge from multiple tasks. So what it does, very easily, you have one adapter tuning here of your transformer for one particular task, you extract one adapter. You have a second task with a second data set, you extract the second adapter. Let's do it here. This is magnified. And then if you have 3, 5, 10 tasks with 10 data sets, you extracted from this model 10 adapters. And now with Adaptive Fusion in January 2021 was now the beauty. We could circumvent this catastrophic forgetting with Adaptive Fusion. We had a beautiful solution if we want to have 10 tasks, 10 specific tasks in your company, or 20 specific tasks. With Adaptive Fusion, you could just use the adapter like a module, put it in, do an Adaptive Fusion, and the model was trained either on 3 specific tasks or on 20 specific tasks. Now I know you want to know, hey, show me here the weight matrices here in our self-attention layer, because this is where our value of our key and our query weight matrices, how exactly is the mechanism? And here I have, of course, the original literature for you. But if you just want to see it here, our adapter here, how it is done, you have here the multiple stacked adapters from your particular training task. And then, as you can see here, let's read it. This includes learnable weights, the weight matrix, query, key, and value. Query takes the input as input, the output from the pre-trained transformer weight. So here we have it zip to the query weight matrix. Both key and value weight matrix take as input the output of the respective adapters. So you see here, input comes here from our adapter stack to key and value, and the dot product of the query with all the keys is passed then into a softmax function, which learns to weight the adapter with respect to the context. So you see everything that we know, very easy. We have the same self-attention mechanism. We have the same value key query weight matrices. We have the same softmax functionality. But we found here with the injection of these adapters a way to train the models on one particular task with one adapter faster, because all the other pre-trained weights are frozen, and we can then add, if you want, the adapter 1, 3, or 5, adapter 2, 114, you can configure your optimal configuration of your LLM. Now, check mark, first point. Adapter transformer. We understand what are adapter transformers, and we understand what the adapter hub is doing, and it is doing it today, and it is a beautiful framework for exchange of adapting transformers. Now, the next part, and this is LoRa. There are a lot of questions about the exact mathematics behind LoRA. What is it really, really doing if you make a deep dive? And you will read sentences like here, a random projection to a small subspace and so, but we now look here at the mathematics of LoRA to understand how we can have the perfect LoRA configuration file for your PEFT model. And remember, PEFT is the beautiful Hugging Face library. Now you understand that this PEFT library and here the adapter hub, those are very similar, let's call it libraries. But on Hugging Face, of course, you have available, let's say, within the platform, all the beautiful models and all the beautiful data sets. So this you would load, have to load extra here in the adapter hub, but I'll show you in a second. So we go here to LoRA. LoRA, if you want to understand it, is a low-rank adaptation of LLMs. And you might say, what the hell is a low-rank adaptation? Now, if I tell you something, just change one character, you will immediately recognize what it is. But it was done October 2021. We have here the paper. Read the paper. LoRA does something that we know now from the adapters. It freezes the pre-trained model weights and injects, now we know what injects means, into our layer structure of our transformer, and injects some trainable elements, exactly like an adapter. They are also, of course, since all AI is matrix multiplication, they are also objects, those are matrices. But now, and this is now the interesting part, you have now a rank decomposition. Now, if I tell you, So in the research paper, they use exactly here, in the self-attention mechanism, they use here the query weight tensor, the key and the value and the output projection matrices. And then they say, during the full classical fine-tuning, the model is initialized to pre-trained weights, phi, and are all updated to phi plus a delta phi. So, repeatedly following the gradient, and you see now they start to separate this into, if you want, perturbation theory. You have here the main master term, and then you have a small delta, a small increment. And this is more or less already half of the idea what they're doing. So, they say one of the main drawbacks for a full classical fine-tuning is that for each downstream task, we learn a different set of parameters, delta phi. As I showed you before with the adapters, for each different task, you learn a complete set of parameters, of weights, of activations for the specific training data set that you have in your fine-tuning. And LoRA adopts now a more parameter-efficient approach. You're not going to believe it, the same as the adapter, where the task-specific parameter increment, now the delta phi, is now further encoded in the delta phi of theta. So what they do here is they say, okay, let's freeze here the main components, the main weights, the heavy weights that come from the pre-training of the LLM, from the pre-training of the vision transformer, from the training here of the stable diffusion, and then just let's look only here at delta phi. Let's only look at this little bit extra term, because pre-training did the main chunk of the training, and then they say fine-tuning is just a little bit extra, and fine-tuning is specific to a task, so this here is just a little bit add-on. And for this add-on, they focus now on this add-on, and they say we use here from mathematics, from linear algebra, and you say, yippee, mathematics, finally! We use here the low-rank representation of a matrix to encode delta phi. And you might say, hey, but how do you know the delta phi is exactly a dimensional equivalent matrix to phi? Well, of course it is, because if you do the classical fine-tuning, all the weights are changed accordingly, and the dimension has to be the same like the master term here. So you know here we have here the same rank of this matrix here, and we have a low rank representation of our matrix, and there we can use our mathematical knowledge. So if you read here in the original paper, this is now from their paper, from their archive preprint, please read the paper. They now say here exactly this, where they have here the pre-trained weight matrix W0, and they have here now this W0 plus the delta W, this delta something, this little bit that comes now from the classical fine-tuning. But now we will have now a trick for our adapter fine-tuning, or our LoRa fine-tuning, however you want to call it. We freeze here W0, so we make it not trainable, and the only trainable part in our architecture, in our transformer network, will be here those additional terms that we call delta V, delta W. Now, what is delta W? We know it's a matrix, and we know it's a matrix with a high dimension and a high rank. Let's say the rank is, I don't know, 11,000. Then we know, finally, from linear algebra, and now I can tell you what I thought I could tell you, we have here a singular value decomposition that breaks down more or less any matrix A into this structure. You know it from linear algebra. We have here a left singular vector matrix U. Find the left singular vectors, those are the columns of U, by finding an orthonormal set of eigenvectors of A transpose A. We have here at the end V transpose. V, find the right singular vectors, the columns of V, by finding an orthonormal set of eigenvectors of A transpose A. And in the middle, and this is the beauty here, we have here a diagonal matrix, only a diagonal matrix S, and we have here in the diagonal this most important singular values starting from top. And those singular values, and you know what they are? They are the square roots of the eigenvalues of A transpose. So you know this from linear algebra. And this is now, yeah, if you want the Eckert-Young theorem, if you want to study it a little bit closer, if you want to have a mathematical proof that it is really applicable here in our case, Eckert-Young theorem. And now you see here, if you now decide you do not go with the full-fledged singular values over the complete rank of the matrix, but you terminate here, if you have a diagonal matrix, you just take the first, the second, and the third element of the diagonal, and you neglect the rest of the diagonal. This is exactly how we get LoRa, because they truncated now the SVD of a higher rank matrix to get a low rank approximation, a low rank adaptation. And this is the mathematical access to LoRa. So again, a truncated SVD, linear algebra, and we find now a reduced rank approximation to our matrix A, or our matrix W of all the weights, the delta W that are now trainable weights, and the rest of the W0 are frozen weights. And as I told you, it is done by setting all but the very first and the k largest singular value in the diagonal. So the rest here we set equal to 0. And when we do the calculation of U matrix calculation, S matrix calculation, V transpose here, we only use now the first k largest singular values, the first k columns of U and V. So in the diagonal, the first top three, the top five singular values we're going to use, and we have exactly a reduced rank approximation of a matrix. And you say, brilliant! And this is the core of LoRa, replacing the diagonal matrix by zeros and the smallest singular values in the diagonal of S. And for the k, and this is now k is a factor in the LoRa configuration, and now you know what k is. Yeah, the beauty is, after this fine-tuning of our two matrices, the low-rank matrices can be reconstructed into a full-rank matrices using the same decomposition technique, and you have the same adapted LLM can be used for the downstream task. Now let me show you this in a very short program. You have here a SciPy, a linear algebra, SVD, and a rank of a matrix. And if we create a matrix with 60 rows and 100 columns, I can tell you the rank is of course 60. There are no linear dependencies within this matrix. And then we just, as I told you, SVD of our matrix, we get a matrix U, this diagonal singular matrix with our singular values and the transpose. And here I show you only here the singular diagonal array. And let's say we choose rank A. So in our diagonal, we just choose the first 8 elements and the rest of the diagonal we set 0. And here you see all diagonal elements, but you see it's ranked. The first one has the highest rank, 38. The second one is already 4, 4.9, 4.8, 4.6, 4.4, 4.4. And if I take here the rank 8, so I take this, the first 8 elements of our diagonal, I multiply with retranspose and with U, and I get an approximation of the matrix when I use rank A, low rank decomposition adaptation. So you might say, beautiful. And now I can use this, because what we achieved is kind of a compression. So where can we use it? We can use it in compression. If you have, normally without LoRA, a memory intensive something array to store, now we can use it by decomposing the matrix into two lower rank matrices. We can represent the matrix now in a more compressed form, which will save us memory and speed up our operation. And this is what we're going to use in LLMs. This is what we use in stable diffusion. So this is LoRA for memory. But if you want, if you go now for image, we have a noise reduction. Because if the matrix has some level of noise or some measurement error, those low rank approximation obtained by truncating the singular value decomposition, you know, after the first 8 diagonal matrix elements, you just truncate and the rest you set 0, you can help reduce the impact of this noise because you just neglect the smaller, noisier part in the image. And of course, if you have now data analysis, for example, image analysis, you can capture the most important feature of an image. Not bad for stable diffusion. Again, mathematics. You have one huge matrix and you can decompose it into smaller one. Or if you want a visual interpretation of this, we have here a door, and this here is now our huge dimensional 10,000 times 20,000 matrix with all the different weights now from that fine-tuning process. And let's say this is our GPU, and you see this is simply too mighty, the data set, that it would fit on a single GPU. So what we do, we apply here our SVD, we truncate it at a certain level, we get two matrices B and A return, and these two matrices will fit neatly in our door, in our GPU. And when the calculation is done, when this has been adapter trained or LoRA trained, and this also has been trained, we take these two, we multiply it back together to the huge matrix, and we have achieved something beautifully. We trained this huge monster here on a GPU with this simple SVD application. Again, mathematics, SVD, LoRA, lowering approximation, yes, M is approximated by M Gilde, given the rank. I want to show you here the last time that it is really into. You have here a picture, 128 to 128 pixels. If you take this now here, this matrix, and you calculate the singular values, and here on the x-axis you have the rank, of course, maximum is 128. You see the singular values, the most dominant part is here, the blue line. Look, here at, let's say, 10, rank 10 here, or rank 20, you have here more or less all the information here already on this rank, and the rest here, if you say 20 plus, is more or less here the end tail. is real, where you have the noise, where you have here not the perfect gray, but a little bit washed out gray. All this is happening here. And this is exactly what we use here, you see, to have here a more memory efficient model. You can have here the culminated information, you can calculate this, and you see, for example, with 20, rank 20 or rank 8, you have here 70% of the whole information of an image already included. And this is the beauty of SVD. Now you know LoRA. Now you know that it freezes here the pre-trained model weights and injects here our trainable matrices into each layer of the transformer. And you know that these matrices here, now they have this very special application of linear algebra, that they have this low rank decomposition trick, where you define a rank and you have an approximation to this matrix. Now you say, what is the performance if you do this to a model? You have here the GPT-2, because GPT-3 is not available. With the adapter, with the very first one I told you here at the beginning of this talk, and then you have here GPT-2 with LoRA. And then you have GPT-T, the official, the trainable parameters, 770 million trainable parameters. You see, with the adapter, we only have 0.8 million, and with LoRA, we have 0.77 million. Now you see with the adapter, and here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 benchmarks, and just look at the comparison of the benchmark data. Here with the adapter, you have 69.1, here you have 70.4, here you have 8.68, here you have 8.89, here you have 46.3, 46.8, 2.49, 2.47. So you see, it is relatively comparable if you have those. So just to show you the performance. And if you compare this now here to here, this GPT-2, of course, GPT-2 is not really competitive anymore, but just as a comparison, you see here, if you have the classical fine tuning, numbers published in prior work, okay, we do not know exactly what this is, but you see, we are absolutely here comparable in the performance benchmark data here to a normal fine-tuning, especially if we have not enough training data. If we do not have tens of thousands of training data for supervised fine-tuning, this is a beautiful methodology to be small, fast, smart, and have the same performance. So, as I told you, we have here as an institution, let's say, the adapter hub, the adapter transformer. This here is, as you can see, the adapter methods. You have now in the adapter methods LoRA. You have prefix tuning, as I showed you in my other videos, already as a methodology in adapter methods. So LoRA is not something new. Exists now for close to 2 years already as an operational model here in the adapter transformer. But of course, and as you can see here, we have here again our transform architecture, and we have here our rate matrices, the query, the key, and the values. And the beauty is now with LoRA, since it takes a matrix and it just finds a low rank adaptation of this particular matrix that it can then recompose, you can take any particular tensor or matrix that you have here, and you can use LoRA on this, and this is why it's almost general available, and you can use it almost on every model. So this is here the simple trick from linear algebra. You decompose here a huge matrix into eigenvector, eigenvalues, and you know everything, and you have here a very, very good approximation of the original weight matrix. Beautiful. Now PEFT. PEFT is now integrated in Hugging Face. So you have the PEFT library with all the other models, with all the data set, with everything in Hugging Face. And now in Hugging Face, you have also LoRA in the PEFT library. So this means you do not have to go here. You have everything here now in Hugging Face. And as I told you, parameter efficient fine tuning, adapter tuning to be more specific here, since this is the general case with adapter, including prefix, including LoRA. You can use it for LLMs. You can use it for diffusion models, stable diffusion. They use it. Dreamboof. Everything that is based on a transformer. You can use it on vision transformer. So these are now the two institutions, the new HuggingFace PEFT library with LoRa. But as I told you, LoRa existed long before. Beautiful. Now, if you have the configuration files of LoRa config where I started today, you have now in the adapter hub, you have here the class transformers.LoRa configuration. And here you have this particular parameters, and you have here the explanation, and you have here again as R the rank. This is the rank of the LoRa layer. I told you it defaults normally to 8, maybe to, default to 8. You can change this. You can play around to find the optimal parameter. You can use it only on the self-attention layer, or you can go it even for the MLP. Whatever you want here, you can do the dropout. You have other hyperparameter for scaling, the reparameterization, and more or less here in PEFT here, and I have you here on the GitHub. Check it up. It's a data class LoRa configuration from the PEFT configuration. And this is here, all the different parameters. Have a look, play around, modify it, find your optimal configuration, and look a little bit around for the famous models like GPT-3. And so there are already the, let's call it, optimal LoRa configuration available. What is the next step? Next step, now that we know LoRa, is, of course, how can we further reduce the size? How can we speed up the calculation? Now, normally we do all our calculation mathematically with a 32-bit encoding of our values. Then you remember float and brain float 16. We use now half precision for our neural network architecture. And then, because it is still that some people do not have access to 320 gigabytes of VRAM or 640 a GPU cluster of 8 Hopper 100. So they say, okay, what can we do to further reduce it? And now the idea was here to have an integer 8 quantization. So the beautiful is now you understand the method here of matrix decomposition in lower rank truncated SVDs. And this is now compatible with integer 8 quantization. You have to be a little bit careful. We'll show you in the next videos when we code this. But of course, by reducing now also the precision of the weights and the activations, now from 22 or 16 bit now to 8 bit integers, you can further reduce on the one hand the memory footprint, but you know there is no free lunch, and increase the efficiency of operations, but you can also affect the accuracy of the model, as reducing the precision of the weights and the activation can lead to loss of information. So yes, you can use 8-bit, but at a certain value, there's a certain threshold where you have to decide for your particular case if bits and byte or 8-bit or anything else, 8-bit integers, for example, is this really the way to go for you if you train for hours and hours and 100 and 200 hours and then you just have an 8-bit accuracy of your values? You have to find an answer for yourself. There are a lot of programs out there where you say, yes, we integrate everything. I've seen integer 4 quantization. Wow. So this is really something think about. Now you understand the mechanism behind LoRa. Again, summary, one sheet. This is to remember. PEFT, the new library in Hugging Face, implementing LoRa. LoRa is currently implemented as a parameter-efficient fine-tuning style for LLMs, for diffusion models, Dreamboof, anything based more or less on a transformer, goes with vision transformer. You can integrate it with Whisper. I will show you in a later video. So beautiful. But remember, LoRa is just one method for PEFT. You can combine LoRa with other methods that are within PEFT. For example, you can have LoRa plus prefix tuning. So you have two PEFT methodologies you can apply. PEFT, of course, is ideal to run after an integer 8 quantization. You can add another idea, some extra trainable adapters using PEFT. This is some beautiful, elegant methodology. And of course, if we look in one of the next videos then for coding here, it is unique for the deep reinforcement learning with human feedback, so to speak, PPO implementation. You can use here PEFT also for this particular task, and I will show you in one of my upcoming videos. So I hope you have now a theory, a theoretical understanding of what's going on here. And the code, as I showed you, is simple 1 or 2 or 3 lines of code. This is no problem at all. The configuration is really something, the fine tuning of your hyperparameters, the configuration of LoRa. I would put my attention over there. And next videos, I will show you how to code this. I say thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed it a little bit. And I'll see you in my next one.